goes slightly off script. Friends, this is this new table, this new altar is absolutely glorious, isn't it? Mm. And what a wonderful focus for us tonight in our worship, to come together in order to have an encounter. We're going to be thinking quite a lot about encounters tonight. And it's a joy that Jesus is going to be meeting with us as we gather in this place tonight. We will say earlier on and remind ourselves in the course of the service that Jesus is with us. And nothing separates us from his love in Jesus Christ. And so, my sisters and my brothers, it is a real treat, a real honour. I always find this is one of the most moving things as a bishop, to come and dedicate a new table or a new altar in a church. And it's a real privilege for you and I, recognising that many thousands and thousands of people, as a result of what we are doing tonight, will have further encounters with the risen Jesus Christ in this place. So, friends, let's offer our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from whom the secrets are hidden, bend the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We have come to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to myriads of angels, to God the judge of all, and to Jesus the mediator of our new covenant. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father,
we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through many measures and wickedness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in the newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sin. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. pray. Everlasting God, you have ordained and constituted the ministries of angels and mortals in a wonderful order. Grant that as your holy angels always serve you in heaven, so at your command they may help and defend us on earth. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
We sit to pay careful attention to the Holy Word of God. A reading from the book of Genesis. Jacob left Beersheba and went towards Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed there for the night, because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up on the earth, the top of it reaching to heaven. And the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And the Lord stood beside him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and to your offspring. And your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south, and all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you and in your offspring. Know that I am with you and will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place! This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The dragon and his angels fought back, but they were defeated, and there was no longer any place for them in heaven. The great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent, who is called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven proclaiming, "Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser of our comrades has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before our God. But they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. For they did not cling to life even in the face of death. Rejoice then, you heavens, and those who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you with great wrath, because he knows that his time is short." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. Alleluia. The Lord be with you.
And
hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. He said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you come to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Tonight, if I may, about places for encounters. I don't mean the sort of close encounter of the third kind, that sort of stuff in terms of perhaps some sci-fi film that we've perhaps been watching, But there's something here tonight, there's something in our reading which speaks to us of an enlarged imagination and an encounter with God. I wonder when your last encounter of that nature was. When you reflect upon your Christian faith, when you reflect upon your journey with God, there will have been some pivotal moments for each of us in church this evening, where we would have felt, experienced some sort of quite strong encounter, something of the Spirit being at work. I remember reading a book on retreat about 3 or 4 years ago, certainly before lockdown. You may have read it, it's called The Divine Dance by theological Richard Rohr. And on the front cover is the hospitality of Abraham icon, Rubio's icon. There's a version there for you just to have a look at it. It's the Trinity. Some people describe this particular icon as the Trinity. And Richard Rohr says that in this particular icon, it's a really helpful gift for us to look at, because when we say our prayers, we are caught up in the dynamic relationship between the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Something, of course, which John's Gospel helps us an awful lot in, particularly the farewell discourses leading to the private priestly prayer of Jesus in terms of chapter 17 in John's Gospel. There's a whole sense in John that John draws us into this divine relationship that is between the Father and the Son, and we are enabled to be in the midst of here by the gift of the Holy Spirit. And these icons, of course, have been designed in order that we may have an enlarged imagination. Something to take us beyond ourselves. Something to take us beyond our experience to perhaps have some sort of encounter with God. These icons are helpful when it comes to thinking of worship. And worship itself isn't something where we try and conjure something up in order to please God. Our worship is a divine relationship where the Spirit, we are told in the Scriptures, enables our hearts to cry, Abba, Father. And we are caught up once again in this divine relationship. If anyone ever comes to my office or sees my chapel, you'll see one of these Rublev icons just in front of the prayer space, which I have at home, to remind me of an enlarged imagination. And in my office, where the table is, the meeting room table that I have just to the side, as if a member of the meeting room, whoever's in the room, includes the gift of the Trinity to remind us that all these different moments are potential encounters with the risen Jesus Christ. Encounters. Having an enlarged imagination, setting the scene so perhaps we are more receptive to something of the Spirit, all becomes a critical part of our day-to-day walk with the Lord. And we have in our Gospel reading, I want to concentrate particularly on the Gospel reading tonight, if I may. In this, the first chapter of John, John beginning to tell this extraordinary story, let's not forget that John was 70-odd years exiled when he came to write these particular words down, or say them, and the scribes were writing these particular words down on his behalf, and every word is laden with all sorts of meaning. Each word being reflected upon to open out our own sense of imagination. And the same is true here at the first chapter of John's Gospel. We have an encounter. It's one of the first encounters that Jesus has with people in the Scriptures. How extraordinary that Jesus sees Nathanael, knows Nathanael, and loves him even before they have spoken. The same is true, of course, for you, and the same, of course, is true for your next door neighbour. Before the encounter happens, Jesus looks upon and knows them and loves them. Jesus, of course, speaks kindly of Nathanael. He builds Nathanael up even before the encounter has actually taken place. He recognises something deep within Nathanael's heart. Unlike many that Jesus has an encounter with in the course of his journey, Nathanael is not hard-hearted. Nathanael has this wonderful questioning sense in his identity. It's almost as if he wants his own identity, his own imagination rather, to be enlarged. He's not set in his ways. He's not up for a fight. He doesn't think that he knows best. But he has this wonderful air about him, which means that he is eager to learn, to discern, and perhaps even discover something of the truth. What a wonderful quality to be inquisitive. Not to have already made up his mind, but to be inquisitive and want to know more. Here is someone with whom there is no guile or deceit, but a kind heart who is eager to learn. Well, you can understand, can't you, how perhaps for Nathanael this may have been quite uncomfortable to have someone who knew him and who loved him even before they'd come to share a word. Jesus says these kind things, and then comes the question from Nathanael, well, how come you know me? Well, of course, Jesus knows us. He knows us better than we know ourselves. And Jesus lets on the fact that he's been watching for a while. I saw you. I was watching you. I saw how you were interacting with the person, not quite at the bus stop this time round, but under the fig tree. I'm watching. I can see what you're like. I can see how you converse with other people. I can see what you're writing on your phone. And he looks at Nathanael and he loves him. Some of the commentators say that the fig tree is an important symbol here, perhaps where the religious teachers, perhaps the rabbis, came to share their learning. There have been set places for these sorts of discourses to take place. And in the midst of this encounter, of course, for Nathanael, was when Philip was also involved. And Philip came and called him. How extraordinary then, Jesus surveying the ground and intentionally calling his disciples, this diverse group of people, into this extraordinary dynamic relationship of love. I find it then something quite remarkable for Nathanael in terms of the way he responds to Jesus, saying that I've been watching you from under the fig tree. Because then immediately we hear from Nathanael a confession of faith. Immediately. This is who Jesus is. The King of the Jews, the King of Israel. Rabbi. It's an extraordinary moment, isn't it? Where suddenly Nathanael, in the midst of this encounter, comes forward with those words. Again, some of the commentators say that this is right at the beginning of John's Gospel. So what's John getting at here? Well, where is the place, perhaps a bit later on in the Gospel, where we see the words, the King of the Jews? Well, of course, it's above the cross. And so some commentators are arguing at this particular point, in this one of the first encounters with Jesus, what John is doing is linking this moment directly with the enlarged imagination of God, with Jesus on the cross being sentenced to death. I think that's quite plausible when we come to look at John's Gospel. There are all sorts of linkages that take place in all sorts of different ways in John's Gospel. So what is going on here, of course, is the writer is reminding us that this is linked with the moment of self-sacrifice of Jesus upon the cross, leading to the defeating of our death, leading to the great gift of forgiveness and the gift of peace, eternity. And the veil in the temple is torn from top to bottom. Something of eternity beckons in this moment, in this encounter with Nathanael. So let's not be surprised as our imaginations are enlarged in the midst of this encounter with the risen Jesus Christ, that we are then catapulted back to that image in Genesis that we've just heard of Jacob's ladder, where again our imagination is enlarged, and in that dream angels ascend and descend, linking heaven and earth, linking our worship, linking our sense of identity, linking our divine encounter with the divine dance. Jesus, the great high priest, presenting us to the Father, leading us in this encounter to eternity itself, whilst also through the cross bringing eternity into our hands. In the beginning was the Word, says John at the beginning of the prologue, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh in Jesus Christ, the symbol of the reality of God's love affair with us, where earth unites with heaven and heaven unites with earth. The most dramatic encounter of all time, leading us that, like Mary and like John, we too kneel at the foot of the cross. Friends, this encounter is about enlarging our imagination. It's about enabling us to see the reality of the cross in our lives, to enable us to live cross-shaped lives, knowing that we are held, knowing that we are loved unconditionally, knowing that with us also is this place of the divine encounter, which enlarges our imaginations. And that's why, my friends, what we do in this church tonight is so important, in the breaking of bread and in the preaching of the word, because in our midst, in this place tonight, Jesus dwells with us. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. A reality which is placed upon this table behind me, where earth again unites with heaven and heaven unites with earth, as the saints and angels ascend and descend upon this altar, crying, "Holy, holy, holy." My friends, our prayer as we dedicate this table this night is that through our prayers, through our ministries, and through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit leading us into that divine relationship between the Father and the Son, that encounter upon encounter upon encounter with the risen Jesus Christ will take place in this place, and indeed right across this parish. This is a night where we remember that earth unites with heaven, and truly the angels ascend and descend upon us. This is about this gospel reading where Jesus looks to you and knows you and loves you, brings about a divine encounter with the one who gave his life for us. With our sisters and our brothers through the centuries, let's stand to affirm our faith in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, Father,
The risen Christ is here in the midst of us. We bring our prayers to him as Lord of the Church, for the Church universal, of which these buildings are a visible symbol. Lord, receive our thanks and prayers. For this congregation, as we remember your promise that when two or three are gathered in your name, you are there in the midst of them. Lord, receive our thanks and prayer. For this place, that we may be still and know that you are God. Lord, receive our thanks and prayer. For the fulfilling of our desires and petitions as you see best for us. Lord, receive our thanks and prayer. For your blessings in the past and for a vision of the future.
Lord, receive our thanks and prayer.
For the gift of the Holy Spirit and a new life in baptism.
Lord, receive our thanks and prayer.
For the pardon of our sins when we fall short of your glory.
Lord, receive our thanks and prayer.
For a foretaste of your eternal kingdom in the sacrament of the Eucharist.
Lord, receive our thanks and prayer.
For the blessing of our vows and the crowning of our years with your goodness.
Lord, receive our thanks and prayer.
For the faith of those who have gone before us, and for grace to persevere like them.
Lord, receive our thanks and prayer.
For the benefactors of this place, who have died in the peace of Christ and are at rest.
Lord, receive our thanks and prayer.
For a sense of our fellowship with Mary our patron, Michael the Archangel, and all your saints.
Lord, receive our thanks and prayer.
O God, from living stones, you prepare an everlasting dwelling place for your majesty. Grant that in the power of the Holy Spirit, those who serve you here may always be kept within your presence. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Now pray for the setting apart of this altar. Praise your mighty and eternal God, that for us and for our salvation you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to be born among us, that through him we might become your sons and daughters.
Blessed be your name, Lord God.
We praise you for his life on earth and for his death upon the cross, which he offered himself as a perfect sacrifice.
Blessed be your name, Lord.
We praise you for raising him from the dead and for exalting him to be our great high priest.
Blessed be your name, Lord God.
We praise you for sending your Holy Spirit to make us holy and to unite us in your holy church.
Blessed be your name.
By this table dedicated to you. Let it be to us a sign of the heavenly altar where your saints and angels praise you forever. Accept here the continual recalling of the sacrifice of your Son. Grant that all who eat and drink at this holy table may be fed and refreshed by the flesh and blood. Be forgiven for their sins, united with one another, and strengthened for your service.
Blessed be the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and ever, and ages.
presence in yourself. As this building is filled with fragrance, so may your church fill the world with the fragrance of Christ. Forth in the church and bring all nations to the fullness of truth. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace. Friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Thank you.
creation, and through our goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed
be you, Lord God of all creation, and through our goodness we have this wine to set before you. Fruit of the vine, work of human hands, it will become for us the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
And the gifts of your joyful church be acceptable to you, O Lord, so that your people gathering in this holy house may come through these mysteries to everlasting salvation.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. You reveal your wise purpose for the salvation of the human race by assigning to the angels and archangels the ministry of your steadfast love and protection while they contemplate your glory. Standing before you and singing your praise, they keep a faithful vigil for us, guarding us along the way that leads to light, and guiding us towards the kingdom of your light. In joyful gladness we unite our voices with theirs, and sing the angelus hymn of your praise.
He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me."
Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again.
And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Now send the Holy Spirit on your people. Gather into one in your kingdom, all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Michael the Archangel and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus, Christ our Lord.
By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Jesus himself has taught us. Our Father, takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. us pray. Lord of heaven, in this Eucharist you brought us near to an innumerable company of angels, and to the spirits of the saints made perfect. As in this food of our earthly pilgrimage we have shared their fellowship, so may we come to share their joy in heaven, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God,
we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, for giving all of you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out to the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
Amen.
Remain with you this night and always.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.